Okay, welcome everyone to my continuation of what is geometric topology. We start off easy today with knots, which I'm going to explain and how to define them properly. It's kind of a little bit painful to define knots, quite surprisingly painful to define something simple as a knot. But I would like to do it because knots are cool. In other words, why not, right? So the usual joke, why not? I hope I'm not going to do this job all that often, but once I definitely need to do it once. So why not studying knots? Yeah, exactly. So here's the main idea. And what I'm going to try to cover are basically a few knot invariants and then maybe a few applications. And eventually these knots will play a huge role on constructing higher dimensional manifolds. And we can also think of them as in surfaces and so on. We'll see some kind of fun stuff. But today, just a knot is something very simple. It's a string in 3-space, whatever 3-space means. 3-space can mean it's R3, like in all the pictures I'm going to show you, or it's S3, which is just R3 and a compactified at one point at infinity. You just bend basically this is idea. This is R, and you can go to S1 by just bending the two sides together and just put them together at the point at infinity. And you can try to do the same in higher dimensional spaces. And you can go from R3 to S3. But anyway, so let's today just think about R3. So a knot is something like this picture here. I really like this picture. And what we can try to study is the knot as a knot, which is a three-dimensional object. Or we can try to study knots by looking at their projections, which are the shadows that you see here. So a knot can have different shadows. So this is a little bit more crazy knot. Actually, it's a knotted protein. So protein can form knots as well. And again, in kind of biology or wherever you study proteins, I actually have no idea. But anyway, so in biology, you will see, again, shadows of the protein, and you need to do some knot theoretical techniques to distinguish, well, different kind of proteins or to read off their properties or whatever. So this is the knot, let's call it K. And this is a knotted protein, let's call it K. Basically, it's a knotted as well. And well, that's basically it. So it's a string that you put into 3-space, and you would like to identify its ends. I show you in a second why you need to identify its ends, but basically is your computer cable that is knotted in 3-space. So here's why you really, mathematically speaking, want to identify the ends, or at least want to fix them somehow, because otherwise you could just undo all knots. Here's an animation that I like a lot. Was produced with Mathematica. It will create a knot for you, a highly non-trivial knot, but it won't close it. And as soon as you don't close it, or kind of to fix the two ends of the knot, you can always undo it, as you will see now. So Mathematica here produces a knot, which is definitely a highly non-trivial knot, a lot of knottings. And as you can see, it doesn't close it. And as soon as you don't close it, you can undo it continuously without breaking operations or whatever. And that's not what we want. And that's the real reason why knots are closed circles and not what they are in real life, like cables that are knotted. But that's kind of a technical glitch. It's totally fine, and I do that all the time, to think of knots as being cables that are knotted. But anyway, so making knots precise is a bit annoying. So let's have a look, actually. It's not so bad as long as you don't want me to prove anything, because that's a bit annoying, as I said. It's not hard, but it's annoying. So basically what you need to do, because we are doing topology and there are just some crazy counterexamples everywhere, just like everywhere counterexamples, you kind of embedding, and a knot is just an embedding of S1 into 3-space, the circle into R3, is not quite what you want to do. You get some crazy counterexamples that I'm going to show you on the last slide. What you rather would like to do is, and that's what we will do in this lecture series, we only consider knots that are equivalent to a polygon. So here's an example. So this is really what you should think a knot is, but secretly I'm only working with those guys here. I will get rid of this description in a second, but basically it's a polygon, and it's a knotted polygon in 3-space again, which is not quite the same as a knot. It's a more restricted notion, but this is what I will call a knot. And the point is, as soon as you restrict your setup to those guys, you can talk about nice projections. So they have nice regular projections without silly points. So you can think of a projection which has some stupid triple points or even worse, and you can just slightly vary them, slightly twiggling them, and you can get rid of the stupid triple points or the worst points. And to ensure that this works in general, you kind of want to have those slightly restricted notion of a knot. So secretly here, a knot is always a polygon. It's still knotted in three space, but it's a polygon. And the point why I would like to do this is that it's equivalent to the following description. So that's kind of what's kind of the geometric description of a knot. And now comes the diagrammatic, the shadow description of a knot. And what we can do is we can just think of a knot as being a projection, right? So define a knot as being a projection. That doesn't quite work because two different knots certainly can have different, one knot can have different projections. So two different projections can correspond to the same knot. So we need the correct equivalence relation on knots. And it turns out that these are the Reidemeister moves. So R0, R1, R like Reidemeister, R2, R3. And they're really, really simple. Like R2 is just put one string on top, what's over the other, just pull it over the other and you can undo it. R1 is something like an unkinking operation, getting rid of this little kink here. And R3 is just, well, you have the strength here in the front, and you can just pull it downstairs, and that's it. And the point is that this is enough. So if I would, I'm doing it right now, I define a knot as being a projection, which is easier to think about. It's a two-dimensional object, and it's modulo these relations, Reidemeister 1, 2, and 3, and the often forgotten Reidemeister 0 relation, which is an isotopy. So you can basically straighten and move around strings. And that's what I can do. I can define a knot in this way. And those two pictures are basically what I'm going to work with. The geometric description of a knot, which is not quite the same, I say it again, as just putting it in three space. It doesn't quite work. We'll see in a second why. And this a diagrammatic description of a knot. And then you could think of, well, that you certainly have something diagrammatic invariance, for example, associated to a knot, which works with Reidemeister moves, or you have geometric invariance associated to a knot, which work as with a knot itself in three space. But the point is, under the correct notion of equivalence for polygon knots, which basically is something like, if you have something like this, a little polygon like this, and you have a full triangle that you could put here in three space and you could straighten it out, and it's just a polygon like this, something like that. So the appropriate equivalence of polygon knots, and you can show that's Reidemeister theorem, that's equivalent to the combinatorial description of knots. In other words, we have now two different ways to think about knots. And if you want, that's why you want the polygonal description of knots, because the shadow description is just so powerful, as we will see. And the main task of knot theory, which I'm going to address in the first few videos in this video series, is to kind of distinguish knots. And that's, as I said, usually not very easy, because one shadow can represent, two shadows can represent the same knot. In this case, he has a very silly shadow, which is just a circle as a shadow in R2. And there's a little bit of a more complicated shadow, this beast here, and they're the same, actually, and it's not so easy to see that they're the same. So what you really want is some kind of way to tell whether two diagrams present the same knot or not. And that's what's called a knot invariant. Right? So you just want to look at the diagram combinatorially and just tell the diagram has an associated number 5, and this would tell me it's not number 5 on a certain list. For example, it's not as easy as just not number 5 on a certain list, but roughly that's what I have in mind. And I should have said actually that projection here, as a shadow, really means I take care of which strand went over and which strand went under. So it's not really a projection, it's kind of a labeled projection if you want. But I will always draw those diagrams here anyway, and you will always see, visually see, which strand goes over and which strand goes under. And it's kind of a funny fact of our brains is that kind of, as long as the picture is not super, super complicated, like this one here, actually it's not so hard to imagine a three-dimensional picture doing the same. For example, here, this is kind of easy to imagine in three space. It's a very knotted diagram. A slight comment here, a slight catch, something I always hate, and I have no idea how to avoid it, so I just don't avoid it, I just don't think about it at all. So there's a different notion, it's called a link, and that's just a knot with two components, something like this beast here, which is called the Hopflink, or this beast here, and I just hate the fact that they're not just also called knots. They're just not. And the only solution I know works for myself is that I just ignore that they are quadrilings and I call them knots anyway. So if I say knots, I implicitly, almost always, unless I specified otherwise, I almost always also include links as well. That's just a little bit silly. Maybe it's silly of me. I should just say links from the beginning, you might say, but I kind of feel like not is a more well-known word and it sounds correct to me, while link is a little bit like a made-up word. I don't know. But anyway, I will just say not. I hope that's okay and it works for you as well. Anyway, so let's come back to this description of a knot. So, of course, I told you we want it because it's equivalent to the combinatorial description, but there is a topological geometric reason why you actually want that. And if you just think of an embedding of S1 into whatever three space or whatever you want to embed it in, this gets pretty crazy. You can have what is called a wild knot. So basically a knot with infinitely many knottings that kind of converge up to a certain point. And these are really, really bad. So kind of they ruin almost all of your theory. There's a theory of wild knots, which is not, as far as I know, not really well developed. But at least for this video series and for most parts of knot theory, we want to avoid them. And the way to avoid them is to just make them polygonal and then you're good. Because in the end, what you want is what is called a tame knot, and I'm going to use that several times. And a tame knot is something that you can thicken up to a torus, and then it's really an embedded torus in three space. And tame knots is, again, one of these equivalences is the same as polygonal knots. That's why you really want polygonal knots, because those wild knots, so not tame equals wild, they have some pathological behavior, which we just don't want. It's just painful. We don't want it. So we rule it out. As usual trick in various parts of mathematics and topology in particular, because if you just consider topological spaces, there are just so many crazy topological spaces and there's almost nothing you can say. So you restrict your class appropriately such that you can kind of get rid of all the crazy counterexamples and only have the nice spaces left. And that's what I'm doing here. And that's why we consider polygonal knots. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the video and I also hope to see you next time.